So, hi, I'm Sandro Cavallari, and I am here to present my work on aspect extraction. So, first, just a brief introduction of how it's going to be the presentation. First, we present what we mean by aspect extraction, how we address the problem, and the result that we get. So, in opinion mining, an aspect is a concept on which an opinion is expressed on. So, for example, in a statement like, "The previous president resigned and his attitude reflected in poor company performance in the last 3 years, while the new board is younger, much business-oriented, more qualified," we can extract two aspects. One is the new board, on which we have a positive sentiment, and one is the previous president, on which we had bad sentiment. So aspect extraction is just the task of detecting those concepts inside a sentence. In finance, we can apply it to better understand streaming of sources like streaming news. Right now, we have Bloomberg or Reuters that always give us short snippets in real time of news that are coming out, but are so fast that are difficult to be digested by a human being. And if we rely only on the sentiment present on those short snippets, we wouldn't have a comprehensive summary of what is written on. Instead, if we are able to take in consideration and provide both the concept and the sentiment, we will have a much better summary and a comprehensive understanding of the news, and is digestible by a human being in in real time. Another way is to apply them to chatbot. Right now, most of the banks are trying to decrease the cost of help desk, implementing some chatbot, and aspect extraction can be used to better understand the user need and redirect them to the correct department to solving their issue. Another way is in credit management system, where right now they are only based on previous facts that come from the market itself and from the user history that has a bank. But they didn't take in consideration the opinion that a banker has on that client. Instead, if you are able to extract some aspect from all the notes that those bankers have put on in the previous history and transaction history, we can build a credit management system that takes in consideration both the previous fact and the previous opinion of the professional banker. So in the literature, there are four main ways to address those problems. One is just based on word frequency and concurrence between noun or noun phrases. Another way is to try to understand the relation that there is between the opinion word and the opinion target. Since each opinion is addressed to an opinion target, there is a independency between those two kind of words in the graph structure of the sentence, and we can leverage those information. Another way is use topic modeling. Topic modeling are probabilistic models that believe that a document is a mixture of topics that are sampled by a prior, usually a Dirichlet prior, and then we can extract the aspect as the word that has the highest probability for each topic. And the last one is a supervised learning, usually using deep learning. We faced this problem using an architecture known as convolutional deep belief neural network. This gave us some advantages. First of all, was able to take in consideration the context of the word, not only a single word, but even the word that appeared before and after it. Then is able to build a probabilistic hierarchical model without putting any assumption of the word distribution. So, with respect to our topic modeling, we don't have to constrain our word to come from a Dirichlet prior, and give us a rich future representation. So, first of all, a deep belief neural network is just a neural network built stacking simpler model. Those simpler models are known as restricted Boltzmann machine and are just a bipartite graph between two kinds of layers. One is a visible layer and one is the hidden layers. And those models are generative models that try to understand the probability distribution of our data set. We can stack many of those restricted boson machines one over the other, and this gives us a deep belief neural network. And the way that is training this deep belief neural network is layer-wise. That means that the hidden node of the previous layer became the visible node of the next layer. A convolutional RBM, instead, that stands for restricted boson machine, is just an expansion in two dimension of our normal restricted boson machine. So instead of having a single vector of visible node, we can have a matrix of visible node, and we can partition those matrix in patches of fixed size and project those patches on the hidden node using a filter. And this operation is known as convolution. We can use many different filters to apply on our visible node, and this gives us the possibility and the ability to understand many pattern of interaction among the world, and to reduce the dimension and give us a simpler representation, we apply max pooling on the top of the hidden node, because max pooling decreases the dimension and only take the information that are really needed, and is mostly an operation that comes from computer vision, but experimentally we found out that is useful even on an NLPM task. The overall architecture is like this. So we have a matrix that represent our centers. Those matrix is partitioned in patches of 5 words. So each column represents a word, but for predicting the word in the middle, we take in consideration even the word that appear before, two words that appeared before, and the two words that appear after it. We projected them on the first convolutional layer that is built using 100 filter and filter size of 2 and 300, because the word are represented using a vector of 300 values. Then another convolutional layer is applied, but this time with 50 filter and filter size of 3 words. And instead of directly predicting the tag of the word, we condition this prediction knowing what was the tag of the previous word. So if we know that the previous word was a noun and was already tagged as an aspect, probably the next word, if it's a noun itself, will have a bigger probability of being an aspect itself, because probably it's going to be a noun phrases. So we try to predict the entire tag sequence of the sentence instead of predicting the tag of a single word itself. So this turned out to be a kind of recursion problem, but we can solve it in an efficient way, because as it's written like here is exponentially, but if we unroll it, you can predict it in a linear time. Then experimentally, we found out that our neural network gave us precise result, but they missing recall. So for handle some special cases, we manually craft some 5 linguistic patterns that are leveraging the information coming from SentingNet, which is a concept level knowledge base. And those linguistic patterns help us mainly to address some special cases that happen in languages. So yeah, in the end, the final output, we tag as aspect all the words that come from the neural network and all the words that come from the linguistic patterns. We perform experiment on 2 datasets. One is the aspect-based dataset, and one is a dataset coming from the challenge of Semeval conference in the 2014. And we try it on 3 different word embeddings. So as I said, each word is seen as a vector of numbers, but those vectors can be generated randomly, and we can just hope that our network learn a way to manage those random number. Or we can use something that Google invented that is word to vect. So they build a neural network that try to understand how world interacts. So this neural network give us an embedding where a word, for example, Paris, if we subtract to the word Paris the word France, and we add the word Roman, give us the vector representing the word Italy, because the way that Paris and France interact is pretty much the same way in which interact Rome and Italy. So this is just was a clever way to build a better embedding. And then we try to build an embedding instead of the one proposed by Google. We just use the same method, but we apply it on a different dataset, which is the Amazon Reviews dataset. And this because instead of having an embedding that represent all the type of document that we can have, we believe that an embedding built only on reviews better handle special cases that are those two dataset, because our dataset also representing reviews. So we are just working on reviews. The first dataset is the aspect-based corpora. We compare our result with OpenAI and DropPrep. Those two are two models that try to leverage the relation that there is between opinion word and opinion target word. And we are almost able to outperform them in any single subdomain that are Canon, Nikon, DVD, MP3, and cell phone, except for Nikon. But if we watch just the F1 score, that is a sort of average between precision and recall, we have an improvement of 3%. On Semeval, we compare it with the ZW algorithm, that is a conditional random fill algorithm, and we got an improvement about of 4 or 5%, and we believe that this higher improvement is due to the fact that this data set is bigger, so deep neural network can leverage much more information and build a much better model, respect traditional machine learning algorithms. So here are the experiment on the linguistic patterns. As you see, our neural network give us quite of a precision result, but we miss some recall, while the linguistic pattern, respect to the precision, give us a higher recall. Combining them, we was kind of surprised that we didn't affect the precision, instead is increased even for 1%, but we was able to increase a little bit our recall. That was our main problem. For what concern the embedding, as you see, random embedding really doesn't work that well, while Amazon, even if it's built on the same way of the one proposed by Google, since it's built only on reviews, and as you can see, all the subdomain of those two datasets was reviews of certain products or some certain restaurant, the interaction among the word in certain reviews, on the reviews, is kind of similar, so this leverages our results. Yeah, thank you.